0344 499 1000 is the number. Let's talk, though, to Dr. Andrew Foxall, who is with the Henry Jackson Society, which is, of course, a think tank. He's the director of the Russia and Eurasia Studies Centre. Dr. Foxall, a very good morning to you.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mike and Kate. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Thank you very much indeed for joining us. Now, this story is incredible in many ways, isn't it? I mean, it's not the first time that somebody Russian has been attacked on British soil. The Litvinenko story, which everybody knows about, which involved polonium being given to him in his tea, involved this polonium being sort of carted around London for several days, certainly, as far as we know, by some people who were certainly connected to the Russian authorities. What do you make of this one?
I mean, it's quite chilling, actually, that comparisons have been drawn almost immediately with, as you suggest, the fate of Alexander Litvinenko, whom, as you mentioned, was killed in 2006 after his cup of tea that he'd been drinking at a hotel in central London was poisoned with radioactive polonium 210. The poison had been slipped into, as I say, some tea that he was drinking whilst he was meeting with two Russian individuals, a gentleman called Andrei Lugovoy and another gentleman called Dmitry Kovtun. The public inquiry led by Sir Robert Owen found that Litvinenko had in fact been murdered, and that it was probably, that was Sir Robert Owen's phrase, probably been approved by Russia's President Vladimir Putin. A number of people have, as I suggested, have immediately drawn parallels and comparisons to the incident in Salisbury on Sunday afternoon and Alexander Litvinenko. I would emphasize that it's too early to comment in any detail, given there are so few details available at the moment. But as your comment suggested, what is clear is that Russia has a history of state-sponsored assassination, including in the UK and on UK streets.
Now, I've got a tweet here. Sorry to interrupt you, Katie. I know you've got something to say here. From somebody called Global, who says, "Stop Russians killing people on our soil." Have you got any proof of that, Mike? I'm hoping, Dr. Foxall, that you can supply some, because, of course, it is circumstantial evidence that we have. You know, how do we know the Russians are doing this?
Well, I would agree with your point that at the moment, the incident in Salisbury with Colonel Sergei Skripal, we simply don't know enough at the moment. However, given his connections to the Russian state, I think it would be foolish if UK authorities were not exploring the Russia connection in seeking an explanation for what has happened. I would say, however, that we know that, as I said, Russia has conducted state-sponsored assassinations on UK streets. Alexander Litvinenko is the obvious example of that. But beyond Litvinenko, there are a number of other there are a number of other incidents where high-profile Russians or Russian dissidents or Russian opposition figures have been have died in the UK under quite suspicious circumstances. So there's the story of Alexander Perepolichny. Now, Perepolichny was a businessman who turned into a whistleblower who collapsed whilst jogging outside of his home in Surrey in 2012. He died suddenly. Perepolichny had been working with a gentleman called William Browder, a high-profile Putin critic, to expose an alleged $230 million tax fraud that had been carried out by Russian officials. UK police initially said that Perepolichny's death was unexplained, and the coroner ruled out any foul play. It was only after, however, William Browder suggested that a full investigation take place that traces of a rare plant poison were found in Perepolichny's stomach. That inquiry, I should say, is still ongoing. But that is just one example, or one additional example, of a whole series of other suspicious deaths involving Russian individuals. It's been in the news a lot over the last day or so. There was an investigation conducted by BuzzFeed in 2017 that alleged that the UK had turned a blind eye to 14 deaths on its own soil, that US intelligence agencies believed were hit jobs either by Russian state security services or Russian mafia organisations.
And building on that, Doctor,
of both of them.
Building on that, Dr. Foxall, I looked at your press release this morning from the Henry Jackson Society, and there's a line in there which just jumps out of me. It says, MI5 believes that there are now more Russian spies in Britain than during the height of the Cold War. They will likely be experienced in all manners of activities, from intelligence gathering to wet work. So basically, we are surrounded in our cities and around and about. We just don't know about it. There are more Russian spies here than ever before.
Well, insofar as we were able to know how many Russian spies there are in the UK, and we know this because of things that have been said by former high-ranking people in GCHQ or MI5 or MI6 once they've left the service, there are likely upwards of 30 Russian spies in the UK at any one time, and they will be engaged with the usual kind of spycraft, intelligence gathering, the kind of spycraft made famous in James Bond and Tom Clancy's novels, thrillers, those sorts of things. But there's also the darker side of things, including wet work, which is in a sense the spy term for assassination and murder, and they will likely be experienced in this sort of thing, not in the sense of that's unique to the UK, but simply that's what spies do. And it would be foolish of us to suspect that some Russian individuals or some individuals working on behalf of the Russian state who are active in the UK don't have that experience.
And of course, people that doubt that Russia has anything to do with any of these things, those who are accused and have an international arrest warrant of murdering Litvinenko, are treated as heroes in their own country, aren't they? So Putin, there's a lot of evidence that Putin is well aware of many things that go on. Now, this case, yet to be proven, will go through a very, very long time, months and months of inquiries, no doubt. But this does show, we do have a track record, and we do see of Putin, this election time in Russia, maybe some people are saying that this improves his electoral chances.
Well, you're quite right that one of the gentlemen whom the UK authorities believe was responsible for the murder of Alexander Litvinenko, a gentleman called Andrei Lugovoy, has been offered and been given protection by the Russian state. The Russians refused to extradite him to the UK to face trial here or even face questioning. He was elevated to a position in Russia's parliament, the Russian state Duma. He was given his own sort of fly-on-the-wall documentary show on Russian TV, and that is, I think, an example of how President Putin treats individuals who are accused of state-sponsored assassination abroad. The timing of this could both work for Putin and work against him. I don't necessarily think that a high profile, if Russia is responsible for this, I don't necessarily think that the timing is good for Putin, given that the presidential elections are due to take place on March 18th. It was.
He doesn't care, though, does he, Putin? I mean, also, don't forget that the guy we're talking about, Sergei Skripal, was indeed convicted in Russia of spying for MI6. So, in the world of Russia, which I'm sure you know better than I do, they'd be quite happy for Putin to send out some kind of assassination squad to take him out, wouldn't they?
Well, I think that there's a danger of believing that everything that takes place in Russia comes directly from President Putin and President Putin's orders. I don't think that's the way that the Russian state operates, and I don't think that's the way that the Russian state, operates. It's very unlikely that President Putin gave a direct order for the assassination of Alexander Litvinenko. I think it's very unlikely that President Putin gave an order for the assassination of Boris Nemtsov, in very close to the Kremlin a year or so ago. I think it's unlikely that President Putin gave a direct order for the murder of Colonel Skripal.
But Dr. Foxall, if you set the scene, if you're a political leader and you set the scene in terms of political will, so if you make it very clear that you do not approve of this, what's going on abroad, then it won't happen. And the fact that you welcome someone back with open arms and you give them a TV show says to me that he's quite happy for it to go ahead.
I agree with you. I think what Putin has done is create the conditions in which it's perfectly acceptable for these actions to happen. And I think the point that you raise is perfectly valid. As I say, I don't think that Putin would have given a direct order for this. There are instances where, in a sense, the Putin system is based on loyalty and displaying loyalty to Putin himself. And one way of displaying loyalty is to undertake actions that you think Putin might approve of, either in the current time or in the future. I think the assassination of Boris Nemtsov was an example of that. I think there are other instances as well, and it may well be that whatever has happened to Colonel Skripal, if indeed Russia is responsible, may well be a sort of rogue element within Russian security services, be that the FSB or the SVR, the Foreign Intelligence Services. So I agree with you that Putin would not necessarily think that this is a negative thing, but I think it's a little simplistic to think that Putin would have ordered this directly.
Well, let's go back to a sort of our broader discussion, because we haven't mentioned yet Boris Berezovsky, and of course he was a guy who had a very unlucky friends. You know, almost all of his friends died of surprise heart attacks, cardiac arrests, a couple of them committed suicide, there was some car crashes going on. You know, nobody really could explain most of what happened to him, but again, nobody could really link it officially to Russia. But I mean, if we add all of these things up, I mean, somebody should be presumably saying we need to stop this happening.
Well, Berezovsky is a perfect example of this. There's a broad trend where those who fall out with the Kremlin tend, or have a habit at least, of turning up dead. Berezovsky, yeah, as you suggest, was a prominent Russian oligarch who fled Russia in 2000 after a pretty high-profile disagreement with Putin. He was found hanged in the bathroom of his Berkshire home in 2013. His business partner, a Georgian oligarch, was found to have died of a heart attack in his Surrey home in 2008. An acquaintance of theirs, Yuri Golubyev, who was co-founder of the Yukos oil giant, died in London in 2007. I think in some senses one only has to join the dots to see that a pretty chilling and concerning pattern is emerging.
And what can we do then to try and just monitor these people more closely? I mean, as Casey was saying earlier on, shouldn't somebody like Skripal have had better protection if he's, you know, turned as a spy?
Well, to a certain extent, the protection that these individuals have will depend on their individual circumstances. So somebody like Alexander Litvinenko, for example, who the Russians believed, and it turns out indeed that he was, cooperating not only with UK security services, but also other security services, and not least the Spanish, would have been deemed a greater threat to Russia and the Russian state than somebody who was no longer active in that world. And to the best, insofar as we know, Sergei Skripal was not working with any security services. So, as I say, the individual circumstances would influence exactly the protection that these sorts of people happen.
And what it looks like is that Putin is very much focused on the fact that he's like an elephant, doesn't forget. And so you could have sold some secrets back in, you know, early 2000, and now no longer of interest to MI5 or MI6 because that was a long time ago. And then who's to know that Putin's not going to come after you, you know, 15, 16, 20 years later? And so how long does that protection last for?
Well, that's the danger. I mean, Putin himself has said that, in a sense, there's no greater traitor to the Russian Federation than an ex or a former security officer who sells state secrets. And
he says they're going to kick the bucket, doesn't he? That's a phrase he's used before. Anybody that sells secrets on us, you know, that turns on our brothers, they're going to kick the bucket.
Indeed, and that should you know, alarm bells should be ringing for individuals who have done this, and also for the countries in which they currently reside. I go back to a point that I made earlier. 12 years on from the murder of Alexander Litvinenko. Let's not remember that we only know what we know about the murder of Alexander Litvinenko because of the tremendous effort that his widow Marina Litvinenko went to hold UK government to account. Successive UK governments, in a sense, tried to, for whatever reason, downplay the relative importance of Alexander Litvinenko's murder, because they would rather have prioritised the economic aspect of our relations with Moscow over the political relations with Moscow. 12 years on from the murder of Alexander Litvinenko, in a sense, the same issues that were brought to the fore by his murder we're now discussing, and it's chilling that these sorts of discussions are happening in 2018.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. Dr. Andrew Foxall, thank you very much indeed. He's from, of course, the Henry Jackson Society, Director of Russia and Eurasia Studies Centre. Now, I don't know what we can do to stop these attacks.